Twogwalapu, Si Avi Ished Chef, Justice Bill Titsta, Buckle Shoot Klinka Opshed. Good morning, everyone. My name is Justice Bill. I'm a student here at the University of Washington. And I'd just like to welcome you all to this space here that we have on campus. This space is the Longhouse is a place that's been around, or in our minds, for over 45 years. But it finally came to fruition in March of 2015 when it opened its doors. And it's symbolic of the people that have resided in this place, a people that I'm proud to call my own. The land you're on today is the traditional land of the Muckleshoot Indian tribe. We are the descendants of the people from this area, along with the Suquamish and Tulalip people. We have family over there as well. So I'd just like to welcome all of you here today, and let's get this started. Yeah.
Greetings, everyone. How you all doing? Thank you, Muckleshoot Canoe family, for that beautiful welcome. My name is Heather Day. I'm the Executive Director of Community Alliance for Global Justice. We're honored to be able to host this event here at the Intellectual House. And I understand that Justice Bill, who spoke's family, has really been integral to making sure this house was built. So. Thank you to everybody who just shared that song with us. And we're very honored to have this tremendous turnout for this event as well. When we first started organizing, we thought there'd be 50 to 100 people, and it just kept growing and growing and growing, and that's a beautiful thing. There should be tons of interest in this topic. So Community Alliance for Global Justice, for those that you don't know, is a Seattle-based organization. We're committed to strengthening the global food sovereignty movement. And food sovereignty is the right of peoples to healthy and culturally appropriate food produced through ecologically sound and sustainable methods, and people's right to define their own food and agricultural systems. We organize by working for fair international trade rules, particularly as they relate to food and agriculture. And we actually were born out of the protests against the World Trade Organization in 1999 and were founded in 2001. And we also fight for food justice here locally in the Pacific Northwest through educational workshops and through solidarity campaigns. And our work here today is one of our solidarity campaigns with the Muckleshoot Food Sovereignty Project and the tribe. We also have a campaign where we partner with the African Food Sovereignty Movement, whose lives are made much more difficult by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So we've been trying to hold the Gates Foundation accountable for the last 10 years for partnering with companies like Monsanto for pushing chemically based industrial agriculture instead of sustainable agriculture in Africa. So we've been working on the issue of genetically engineered salmon since 2014. And we're here, early 2017, 3 years later, thanks to the fighting spirit of my sister, Valerie Segrest. I heard Valerie give the keynote at the Domestic Fair Trade Association conference in January 2016, where she made an eloquent appeal to stop the madness that is GE salmon, and her words really touched me. They actually moved me to tears. Still. Okay, I always cry. So we had just won a major victory at that time when after a year of pressure, CHEJ with our partners, Friends of the Earth and others, got Costco to make a public statement that they won't sell GE salmon if it comes to market, which is a really big deal because Costco sells more salmon than any other retailer. However, this victory came on the heels of a major defeat. In December 2015, the Food and Drug Administration had just approved GE salmon for human consumption. And this is really important because it's the first ever animal approved for human consumption anywhere in the world that's been genetically engineered. Here in the Northwest, we live on Coast Salish land. Those of us who are non-native US citizens are treaty partners with Coast Salish tribes, who have observed and sustained our invaluable fishery for thousands of years. CHEJ, my organization, Community Alliance for Global Justice, we believe that as we collectively consider the implications of GE salmon entering our food system, tribal perspectives should be at the center of that discussion, and yet tribes' treaty rights are being completely ignored. Valerie made me realize the critical importance of continuing to fight against GE salmon despite the FDA approval, and to do so because we're a Northwest-based organization that cares specifically about the central role that salmon plays in our region. Oh, and especially in Coast Salish culture. We recognize that this is only one of many issues facing fisheries, and we're grateful for the leadership of the many Coast Salish tribes who are centrally involved in finding solutions to the crisis facing salmon and have been involved for decades. So that's why we're here today. We thank you so much for joining us. The program has been changed a little bit just because of timing of cooking the salmon, so I'll just give you a quick overview. So we're, instead of starting with lunch, basically we're just flipping things. So we're gonna start by hearing from Valerie, and then from Pete Knudsen of Loki Fish Company. And then, oh no, that's not right. Before Valerie, we'll be hearing Roger Fernandez tell a story, so I'll introduce him in a second. And then some speakers, and then lunch, and then a final closing and call to action. We welcome you here today to learn more, to feed your bodies, to feed your souls, and we hope you'll be inspired to continue working with Community Alliance for Global Justice and the Muckleshoot Food Sovereignty Struggle Project in the struggle. So there's a sign up that was in the front hall that we'll be passing around during the event, and we ask that you please add your name and contact info, even your address, so that we can be in touch moving forward on actions that we can take together. And at the end of the event, we'll be announcing specifically how we want everyone to take action with us. And you'll understand better. But having your address will be helpful because we're going to be putting pressure on the Washington State Legislature. For folks who are into social media, on this sort of salmon-colored piece of paper. We've written up the hashtags and Instagram and Twitter handles, or whatever you call it. See, you can tell I'm really good at this. For folks to add to your comments on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. And also just wanted to point out the books that were at the entrance. Many of you probably have gotten a copy. We published that in 2012, and actually it's through the book Our Food, Our Right, Recipes for Food Justice, that Community Alliance for Global Justice first started working with Valerie, who with her colleague Elise Crone contributed to the book. And many of you maybe were at the dinner, our big annual dinner where they give the keynote. Because of their participation in that project. So we have lots of those books and just want to get into the hands of people who care about food justice and food sovereignty, so you're all welcome to take a book today. There are donation baskets around. We appreciate donations if you're able, but this event is free thanks to the generosity of the Muckleshoot tribe who's funding this work for CAGJ. But we do have some costs that were unexpected. So if you can make donations, we appreciate it, but they're certainly not required. So with that, I want to invite up Roger Fernandez, who for many of you I'm sure doesn't need an introduction. Roger is a member of the Lower Iluaklalam Indians and is a storyteller, artist, and native historian, and it's really an honor to have him here to open up the event. Please welcome Roger.
Thank you, good people, for allowing me to stand up and share a few things with you today. My name is Roger Fernandez. I am from the Lower Elwha Nixkalayim people. We are called the Klallam people by the modern English speakers because apparently the English speakers couldn't say our real name, and so they called us Klallam. But we are Nixkalayim, which means strong people. And as I was listening to the speakers set the tone for this event, I wanted to say a couple things before I tell some stories. But these are stories. Anything we share like this is a story. But storytelling and telling stories are two different things in my opinion. I might explain that as I go along. But my people, the Klallam people, that live along a river, the Elwha people, will live along the Elwha River. About 100 or so years ago, two dams were built along that river illegally. They were built with no fish ladders, because whoever built those dams said that we don't need the salmon, it doesn't matter. We'll farm them, we'll create little aquaculture centers, and we'll raise salmon in pens, which is an abomination if you ask me, but they said that's what we'll do. And so they didn't put any fish ladders, and so the fish runs were wiped out. Our people tell stories of when the salmon returned after those dams were built, that the salmon were crashing their heads against the wall trying to get through the dam. The river was full of their blood as they tried to get back up river, but they were blocked by this dam. Some people tell the stories of our people actually lifting up the salmon and carrying them around the dam, but there's only so many people and so many salmon you can do in this manner, and so the salmon runs were wiped out. 100 years later, the people has always resisted those dams and said that we must bring those dams down, they must come down. And people were telling them, you can't do that, you can't take down dams on a river. It's never been done before anywhere in the world, dams of this size. And so if you follow the news, and I'm sure you have, you know that a few years ago, the dams were brought down along the Elwha River. And the salmon, the fisheries people said the salmon might return in maybe 4 or 5 years if they return at all. But within 6 months, the salmon were coming back up the rivers. And so they were waiting for this time to happen. This might sound like I'm bragging about my people, and I am, but the things people say are impossible are not impossible, because they developed many alliances with people, non-native people, to help make that happen as well. So it was not just the native people, it was many, many people who came together and realized we must bring the world back to some balance, some order, and so the dams were taken down. Just north of here, there was an idea to create a coal terminal where all these coal trains would come, and they would bring their coal from other places to the east. They would bring them here, load them on the ships, and take them to other places in the world. And the tribes up there, like the Lummi and the Swinomish and other tribes, said that can't happen. You can't bring your poison into our land because it will kill the salmon. It will affect the water. And so they went in legal and political means. They were able to shut down those coal ports. And so, again, Native people saying in behalf of the salmon, behalf of the environment itself, the world itself, some of the things you're trying to do, you can't do. They're poisoning and destroying the earth. And so our people here have been organized to the point where we can make some things happen. But we need allies to do that, of course. We need people that will join with us to do it. So there's so much that can happen that this wonderful event talking about the salmon themselves, that conversation has to be had. But it can't be just the Western view of salmon. A fish that swims the water that we catch and we eat as an economic and nutritional resource, to the Native people, they're much more than that. And so I'm going to share a story with you, a traditional story. Now, my belief, what I was taught and what I built upon, is the idea that when people come to an environment, they look at that environment and they observe how it works, and then they build their culture around that environment. So the people that first came here looked at the world and said, there are mountains surrounding a saltwater body, there are rivers flowing out of those mountains that go into the saltwater, and there are forests that cover the mountains, and there are salmon that come up the rivers at certain times of the year, and there are shellfish that cover the beaches, and that's how we build our culture then. We build our culture around that. And that's just an example of how people anywhere around the world would have shaped their culture. Western culture, in my opinion, has the model that they take the idea of the city and they put it everywhere. And so they stamp that model that they've created and they put it everywhere. I've never been to Paris, but I'm pretty sure I could figure it out when I got there. It's a lot like Seattle. You've got all these tall buildings and streets and you've got lights, and I can figure that out. But again, that's a model that does not conform to the environment. It's a model that makes the environment conform to it. And so right now, I think we need to rethink some of these things. And to do that, can we listen to the old stories of the old people of a certain land, like this land right here, and learn from that? So the story I'm going to share, the first one is a very long story that explains how the world came to be, the world we live in today came to be, because so many of our old stories talk about there was a world before this world, and how it was shaped so human beings could live in the world. So this story then is not what I would call pure science. There was science within it, but it's not pure science, because science satisfies our mind. These stories satisfy our spirit, our heart. And so there's the mythic stories that we tell, oftentimes they sound like a dream. They sound like a dream because so many things that our modern mind might say, well, that can't happen, that never happened, and therefore we dismiss the story. Since those things never happened or could never happen, then the story's not true, and if it's not true, we don't pay attention to the story, and therefore the story has no meaning. But as I was taught, and I believe, the stories are not speaking to our mind, they're speaking to our heart. Our heart needs to understand the meaning of things. And so a story like this I'm going to share with you, talk about the meaning of things. And I want you to notice at the end of the story where I'm going to end it, because it's a very long story. I'm not going to tell the whole story, I'm just going to tell the beginning. Where does it lead us? This story is from the people of this land. I come from people who come from across the water, about 100 miles from here. So I acknowledge that this story comes from the Snoqualmie people, the Green River, the White River tribal people, the Muckleshoot people, the Duwamish people, all the tribes that lived along that river system, that live along that river system. And so this story goes, a long time ago, two sisters, Yisbleek and Jameen, went out into the world, and they were gathering plants. They were gathering plants as their work was to make things, to make baskets and clothing and to make mats and things like that. They were gathering plants, and they were out in the woods for many, many days. The night before they would return home, they built a small fire. They built a small fire, and they lay down to go to sleep. And as they lay down to sleep, the younger sister pointed up in the sky and said, "Look, sister, look. There are two skies, up in the sky, there are two stars shining. There's a red one and a white one. Do you see them?" And the sister said, "Yes, I see them." And the younger sister said, "I wish we could marry those stars. I would marry the white one and you can marry the red one." Her older sister said, "Please, sister, go to sleep. We need this rest. Don't be talking like that." Well, in the morning when they woke up, do you know where they were? They were in the sky world, and they were married to those stars. They were married to the stars the sister had wished upon. The older sister was married to the Red Star, who was a young, handsome, virile young man, very tall and beautiful hair, and she was married to the Red Star. The younger sister who had made the wish, she was married to the White Star, and he was an old, decrepit old man with long white hair and wrinkly skin. His eyes, they say, were crusted shut because even the brilliance of his own light caused his eyes to crust shut, and so she was married to this old, old man. My teacher, Vi Hilbert, said, "Be careful what you wish for." So, after a time, the younger sister and her old husband, the White Star, they had a baby. My teacher said, "Oh yes, these things happen." They had a baby. And the baby was called Star Baby. Star Baby, a beautiful baby that glowed like a little light bulb kind of, he glowed. He was called Star Baby. And the sisters now had a child in the sky world. The aunt and the mother, they lived in the sky world of the stars, but they were homesick. They wanted to go home. They would go gathering plants all the time in the sky world. They did the work in the sky world that they did on the earth below, and they were gathering plants. And they were told as they go out to gather plants, never dig up a plant that has roots that go straight into the ground. Only gather the plants that have roots that spread out. Never dig a plant that has a root that goes straight into the ground. Only the ones that have roots that spread out. And so the sisters did this every day until one day they decided to dig up a plant that had a root that went straight into the ground. And they did that, they pulled the plant out by its root and they made a hole in the bottom of the sky world. And they could look through the hole and they could see the earth below. From the sky world, far above, they could see the earth below. And they could see their mountains, they could see their river, they could even see their village far below. And now they were very homesick. They wanted to go home. They decided that they would build a rope they would make a rope to get down below. So every day they would go out gathering. They would go gathering plants. But instead of bringing them home, they would weave a rope. They were braiding a rope out of grass and bark and roots. And after 14 days, they made a rope that went all the way to the earth below. It touched the earth below. And they took the baby and they crawled through the hole and they were climbing down the rope. They covered the hole above them so the sky people did not know where they had gone. And they came back to the earth. They climbed down the rope to the earth. And everyone was so happy to see these sisters. They had returned. They had disappeared. They thought they would never see them again. But they had returned with a beautiful baby that glowed like a light. They came back with Star Baby. The rope itself that hung from the sky, the people turned it into like a big ride. They would take that rope and drag it up to the top of a mountain, and they would swing across the Snoqualmie Valley to another mountain. And they would swing from that mountain to another one and another one. They called it the Great Swing. The Great Swing. And people would take that rope and they would swing across the sky world, across the mountain, from mountain to mountaintop. Even the animals were doing this. The animals were using the rope as the Great Swing, swinging across the mountains from mountain to mountain. And one little animal wanted to use it. It was Little Rat. But the other animal said, "Rat, you're a dirty little animal. We don't want you to use this rope. Go on, get out of here." Rat was angry. And one night, while everyone was asleep, Rat climbed all the way to the top of that rope, and using his sharp little teeth and little claws, he bit and scratched until that rope broke and it fell to the earth below. There's a pile of rocks, it's still there today, in the middle of the Snoqualmie Valley. That is the rope that fell. Well, the sisters, again, they returned to the work they'd always done, gathering plants. They worked with plants and weaving. And one day they decided to leave the baby with Grandma Frog, that Grandma Frog would watch the little baby while they went out gathering plants. And so Grandma Frog was an old woman and she was blind. And she would hold the baby and sing to it. "Oh, you're such a sweet little baby. Oh, you're such a cute little baby." She would sing to this baby all the time. And someone heard the old woman singing about a beautiful baby. And they came to investigate. It was the dog Salmon people. They came and they saw this old woman holding a beautiful glowing little child. And they said, "We will take that baby from that old woman." And so they waited until the grandmother frog put the baby down. It was wrapped in a blanket. And she went off a few feet to pick berries that were ripe. While she had her back turned, the dog Salmon people came. And they took the baby out of the blanket. In its place, they put an old rotten piece of wood. They wrapped it in the blanket. And they took the baby and they took it away. Grandma Frog returned and picked up the blanket and started singing again. Oh, you're such a beautiful baby. Oh, you smell like a rotten piece of wood, baby. You feel like you're a rotten piece. The baby is gone, she began to scream. The baby is gone. And the sisters came and the baby was gone. And now they were desperate. They were screaming as well. And the people got, everyone looked for that little baby. And no one could find that little one. Even the animals came and they looked and they couldn't find the baby. And then the birds volunteered to help as well. And the birds came together and they knew they would look for this little baby. And first came Crow. Crow said, I will look for that little baby. And Crow flew off and came back in one day and said, I came to the mountains and I couldn't go any further. I flew as far as I could to the mountains and I couldn't go any further. But there was a light shining on the other side of the mountains. Then came Hawk. Hawk, I'm bigger than Crow. And Hawk flew off and was gone 2 days and came back and said, I went to the top of the mountains, but I couldn't go any further. And Crow is right. There's a light on the other side of the mountains. Then Eagle came forward and said, I will go. And Eagle flew off and was gone for 4 days and came back and said, I went across the mountains. I came to the place where the sky lifts up and crashes down. The sky lifts up and crashes down. And I couldn't go any further because that sky would crush me. But there is a light on the other side of that sky. And then little Blue Jay said, I will do it. And Blue Jay flew off, went across the mountains and came to the place where the sky lifts up and crashes down. The sky lifts up and crashes down. And Blue Jay was trying to time it to get across that crashing sky. And he put his head into the sky and it crashed upon his head. That is why Blue Jay has a wedge-shaped head. Blue Jay finally got across to the other place in the sky world and he came to a river. And there was a young man, the little baby had grown very quickly, there was a young man standing by the river and he was making arrowheads. He was chipping away at stones making arrowheads and he had a pile of rock dust at his feet. And Blue Jay came up to him and the young man had never seen anyone like Blue Jay before and he was frightened and he took a handful of that rock dust and he threw it at Blue Jay, blinding him and Blue Jay squawking, ah, why did you do that? Why did you do that? You blinded me. And the young man said, I don't know who you are. You frightened me. I've never seen you before. Blue Jay said, I am Blue Jay, and I've come to take you home. You do not belong here. This is not your home. You were taken by the dog Salmon people when you were a baby, taken here, and I've come to bring you home to your people. And the young man said, I knew I didn't belong here because the people here have shiny skin, and I just have this plain skin here. I will go back with you. And the young man said to the dog Salmon people, you took me from my family when I was a baby. You took me away from the ones who loved me when I was a little child. And I should punish you for this. I should punish you. But I will not punish you because you raised me as your own son and you loved me. You raised me in a good way. I will not punish you then. I will honor you. I will honor you. I will put you into the river and you will swim up and down the river and the people will catch you for their food. And that's where I'm going to end the story because it goes on, because he changes the whole world and gets it ready for the people to come. The first thing the creator did, we call him the changer, not the creator, but the changer. And we also call him the transformer. He has many names. Stokwal, the Snoqualmie people are named from him. That is the moon. Moon the transformer, Stokwal. You have Duhwabach, you have Labatea, you have Hall, you have many names for this being who came into the world and got it ready for the people to come. He came into the world and got it ready for the people to come. That was his role, to prepare this world for us people. He made trees, he made deer, he made everything we need to live in the world, he created for us. And so it's important to understand then, our people explain this story and what is the first thing he created so that we might live in this world? What is the first thing he made so we could live in the world? He made salmon. And so according to this teaching and this story, salmon is the first creation, the first thing. And the native people say the world we live in is not the human world, it is the salmon's world. The salmon is the thing everything builds its life around. Think of all the things here that eat salmon. People eat salmon, bears eat salmon, whales eat salmon, seals eat salmon, otters eat salmon, eagles eat salmon. I could go on and on and on and on and talk about all the things that build their lives around salmon. So our people look at the salmon in so many lights. First, it was the first food that was created for us. It's the only reason we can live here. It's the world is built around salmon. Everything here relies on salmon as well. And then you look at the salmon, and it teaches another powerful lesson. As the salmon return up the rivers, like they did at the Elwha River, they would return up the rivers by the millions at one time, by the millions. The people would say, the river was so full of fish, you could walk across the back of the salmon on the rivers and not get your feet wet. This is how many salmon would fill the river. And we pointed out, and our people would always point out, look at the salmon. They come back up the rivers by the millions to give us life, to give us food, to give us life. And they ask for nothing in return. They ask for nothing in return. And so it's a powerful lesson, because our people have said, this is how we must live in the world. We must give and give and give to each other and expect nothing in return. So the salmon not only feeds us in our bodies, they also feed us in our spirits. And so the salmon is very important to our people. It's the center of the world. And everything that is done, like this event here, that can save the salmon and help the salmon, is a powerful act. And you being a part of that become powerful people. I mentioned before the transformer. The transformer's job was to create the world for the people to come, to get the world ready for the people to come. And the more I told that story, the more I realized that is all of our job. All of our job is to get the world ready for the people to come. What are we doing on a day-to-day basis in the work that we're doing or the things that we say to get the world ready for the people to come? And so again, our people learn from the stories because we tell these stories and carry them in our heart. These stories are carried in the heart of our people. We didn't carry these stories in books. We didn't carry them in our cell phones. We carried them in our heart. And that's where the stories do their work, in your heart. So again, I wanted to share that story very quickly with you because this is the order of the world. It's a salmon's world we live in. To think otherwise is to deny the truth right in front of us, our people say. And so look at the world and the way it works, and you will recognize that salmon gives life to everything. If we humans disappeared, the world would be just fine. But if the salmon disappeared, the world would have to be recreated. So we tell another story I want to tell. It's not a very long story. It's told by different tribes in different ways around here. And it is about salmon. And salmon, again, to us, because of the story, reminds us that they're really people. They're not just a fish. They're really people like us. And so we have a name for them. One name Vi Hilbert taught me is Ubulch, which means the salmon people. So we call them the salmon people. We say that they live in villages under the ocean. At a certain time of the year, as humans, they become salmon. They change, they put on salmon skin, and they come back up the rivers to feed the people who live on the land. So we call them the salmon people, the powerful beings who live in the villages under the ocean, who return to give us food, to give us life. That's the salmon people. And we must honor them. And many tribes do different things. First, salmon ceremonies, celebrations, songs, dances. And some tribes, like my tribe, we put their bones back in the water. After we're done eating the salmon, we return the bones to the water so they can use the bones to come back again, to regenerate, to come back. And so this story then refers to the salmon people and why we put the salmon bones back in the water. A long time ago, in a village not far from here, there lived a little boy. And this was a very, very, very bad little boy. He was a really bad little boy. He was always lying and cheating and fighting and stealing and complaining. He never did his work. He never shared anything. He was a really, really bad little boy. And I'm sure there are no little boys like that in this room right now. Well, he was a terrible, rotten, terrible little boy. Now, in this village, it was a job of the children to return the salmon bone to the water. And when the grandpa said, it's time to take the salmon bone back to the water, all the children, except one, ran up to the pile of salmon bones. And they scooped up big handfuls of bones, and they walked out the door, heading down the trail to the river to put the salmon bones back in the water. All the children were doing this, except one. And you know who that one was, right? That terrible, rotten little boy. He said, Grandpa, leave me alone. I don't want to do that. I'll do that another time. The grandpa said, this is a very simple thing. This is how we show respect to the salmon people. Do it now. Well, I said, all right. And he went to the place where the salmon bones were, but there were only a few little bones left in the dirt. So he scooped them up in one hand, and he walked out the door, following the other children, heading down to the river to put the salmon bones in the water. And he was walking really slow. And pretty soon, He couldn't see anybody, and nobody was around, so he threw the salmon bones in the bushes. He said, "There, no one will ever know." And he went home to play. A few days later, he was playing on some big rocks by the side of the river, and accidentally he slipped and he fell into the river, the deepest part of the river. And he would have drowned, except under the water, someone saved him. Do you know who saved him? The salmon people saved him. And they took him back to the village under the ocean, and they took very, very good care of him. They're very kind and loving. They gave him good food. They gave him warm blankets. All he had to do all day long was run around the village playing with the salmon children. And the boy was so happy. He said, "They're so nice to me here. They're so good to me. I love it here. I will never leave. I will stay here forever." But one day something happened that changed everything. One day he was playing with the salmon children, and he saw a little salmon girl, and she was trying to run with the other children, but one leg she couldn't run on. She was dragging it behind her, and it looked as though it hurt when she tried to run on that leg. It looked as though she had no bones in her leg. She would try to play catch with the other children, but one arm she could not lift up. It looked as though it hurt when she tried to lift that arm. It looked as though she had no bones in her arm. And right away, that little boy knew what had happened. He knew what happened. He knew the bones he had thrown away into the bushes like garbage. They never made it back to the salmon people. And now this little girl was suffering. She was in pain because of him. And he knew he had to do something. So he went to the salmon people and he said, "Can you take me back to my village on the land? I have important things to tell them there." And the salmon people said, "We can take you back to your village, but if you leave our village, you may never return. You may never come back to the salmon village again." And the boy thought, and he said, "It's very important. I must go. Please take me home." And so the salmon people took him back to his village on the land, and he came walking out of the water in front of the village. And the people were amazed to see him. They thought they would never see him again, but here he was returning to them. And they were so happy, they rushed up to hug him and to greet him. But the boy said, "Wait, stop, wait, I have important things to tell you. First, that spoiled, rotten, mean little boy that you used to know, that is not me anymore. I have changed. I'm a good person now. And I must tell you what I have learned. The things we do on the land affect the things that live in the water. The things we do on the land affect the things that live in the water. We must respect and protect the house of the salmon people. We must respect and protect the house of the salmon people." And this is what that little boy taught his people from the time he lived with the salmon people in their villages under the ocean. And that is all. That story is called Salmon Boy. And many tribes tell variations of that story about a little boy who is very, very bad at the beginning of the story. In his meeting with the salmon people, returns a better person with a teaching that shares the importance of the salmon to our people. And so again, within our stories, we're taught so many things. Like all stories, they teach us something. The culture that tells the story is trying to tell us things. And in this story, the salmon people are the center of the world. In the Transformers story, the salmon people are the first creation. So everything we do then to save the salmon, every small thing we do, is very important. So I'm going to ask us all to do something. I don't think they expect me to do this, but I'm going to do it really fast, all right? I want you all to stand up. All right, do salmon have feet and legs like us? No, they don't. They have a long, skinny body, so put your feet together. Do salmon have hands and arms like us? No, they don't. What do they have? Fins, so put your hands to your hips. Guess what you are now? You're a salmon. All right. So we're going to do a salmon dance. It's very simple. I learned this from a teacher. His name was Beaver Chief, and it's a simple little dance. As I hit the drum, I want you to bend at your knees. Always keep your feet together, hands on hips, but bend at the knees when I hit the drum. Very good. And you have to bend to the beat of the drum. Salmon aerobics. Very good. And when I start to sing the Indian words, Ibashtiak Lada, thank you, salmon people, I want you to go back and forth and back and forth. So you're bending at the knees and going back and forth. You're a salmon swimming very slowly in the water. Then at the end, I'll hit the drum very fast. And that means you're going really fast back and forth like this. A salmon swimming very fast in the water. And at the end of the end, if you can do this. When I hit the drum once really loud at the end, I'm going to take one jump out of the, one jump. That means you're a little salmon jumping out of the water. All right, just one jump. Whew, that's a lot of instructions. All right, I think we can do it. Wake up on a Saturday morning. Here we go. So, salmon dance. Ipash the aklada. Ipash the aklada. That last part of God. Very good. All right. So, thank you. You can sit down. So, in our, among our people here of the Puget Sound region, you see us put up our hands like this all the time. You see this gesture. We call it putting up our hands to people. And I was taught it means hello, goodbye, thank you, you're welcome. It has symbolic meaning as well. Another being that lives here and gives us everything and asks for nothing in return is a cedar tree, the long life maker cedar tree. And if you look at the cedar tree and you look at the top branches, as it's growing, the top branches are like this. As it gets growing older and the branches begin to drop. And in the beginning, the cedar tree is like this. And the people say, look at the cedar tree. You give thanks every day. We must give thanks like the cedar tree. And the other symbolic meaning of this gesture I was taught means you lift me up. You lift me up, you lift up my heart, and you make me happy. So I want to thank, in the Klallam language, Khatniksen means thank you. Khatniksen to the people who put on this wonderful event. Khatniksen to the people that are working to make this event successful today. Khatniksen to all of you for being here to support the salmon people. And again, I hope to see you again. Khatniksen Siam. Thank you very much.
Feeling nourished? All right, just another hour until kale salad and amazing coho salmon. So for those who are new, my name's Heather Day. I'm the Executive Director of Community Alliance for Global Justice, and I'm just up here again to introduce our speakers, Valerie Segrest, Pete Knutson, and Steve Mashuda. So I'm gonna read their bios, so you know a little bit about them before they all come up. So Valerie is a native nutrition educator who specializes in local and traditional foods. As a member of the Muckleshoot Indian Tribe, she serves her community as coordinator of the Muckleshoot Food Sovereignty Project and also works as traditional foods and medicines program manager. In 2010, Valerie co-authored Feeding the People, Feeding the Spirit, Revitalizing Northwest Coastal Indian Culture. Valerie received a Bachelor of Science in Nutrition from Bastyr University and a Master's Degree in Environment and Community from Antioch University. She is a fellow for the Institute of Agriculture and Trade Policy and a PhD student here at University of Washington's College of Built Environment. Valerie aims to inspire and enlighten others about the importance of a nutrient-dense diet through a culturally appropriate common-sense approach to eating. Pete Knutson was born in Seattle and raised in Everett, Washington. He co-founded Loki Fish Company with his wife Hing in 1980, and it's still run by them plus their two sons. And I have to say, They've taken very good care of me and my husband. My husband's been working for Loki for several years as well. Loki takes pride in directly marketing every salmon that is harvested aboard their two boats. You can find Loki Fish Company every weekend this time of year and all year round, but this time of year at the Ballard University District and Broadway Farmers Markets. Pete has been active in numerous local marine conservation issues regarding the protection of salmon habitat and sustainable fisheries, including the fight to preserve fishermen's rights at Fisherman's Terminal. He's a founding member and commissioner of the Puget Sound Salmon Commission, who advocates for the protection and stewardship of salmon in Puget Sound in Alaska. In addition to being a fisherman, Pete amazingly has a PhD in cultural anthropology and teaches at Seattle Central Community College, and he is the first professor to welcome me into his classroom when I just started activism in the late 90s or something, and he was so wonderful. It was a great start for me, so thank you, Pete, for welcoming me that way. I've never forgotten it. Finally, Steve Mashuda is the managing attorney of the Oceans Program of Earth Justice and works in the Northwest office here in Seattle. Earth Justice is the largest nonprofit environmental law organization in the U.S. Steve is co-lead counsel for the lawsuit brought by a broad coalition of environmental, consumer, and commercial recreational fishing organizations and the Quinault Indian Nation, challenging the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, the FDA, for approving GE salmon. Mashuda joined Earth Justice as an associate attorney in 1998, where he specialized in Clean Water Act, Forestry and the Endangered Species Act litigation. Mashuda received his JD from Vermont Law School in 1997, and he also holds a Master's of Studies in Environmental Law from Vermont Law School and a BA in History Sociology from the University of Dayton. So please welcome Valerie Seagrass, who will speak first.
Good afternoon, and thanks for coming. I'm so just taken by the presence of people that are here, and it's such an honor. It's really an honor to be in the presence of people who are willing to, on a Saturday, drive down here and find parking, and then come in and really think together about salmon and how important that is. Heather introduced a little bit of the work that I do. The Muckleshoot Food Sovereignty Project began in 2009, right as I was coming out of school from studying nutrition. And I spent 2 years there at Bastyr really struggling with figuring out how to take the information that I was learning around biochemistry and science and anatomy and physiology and come back and make a change in people's diets in my community. I had been sent there by my elders, who I took care of and took to doctor's appointments and witnessed the suffering that happens from completely preventable nutrition-related diseases. And I had big questions. So I'm very lucky that right as I was coming out of school, I was able to spend some time with Roger Fernandez, who just shared all those beautiful things. And one thing about storytelling that has been really impactful is how it can really inform and shape your work. And something that Roger always says is to make sure that storytelling comes first, that that's our traditional way of learning. And so I'm really grateful that he came here today and shared and spent that time with all of you. Because when I was coming out of school and was all about getting everybody back to a traditional foods diet, he was the one who looked at me and said, but nowadays our traditional foods and medicines are and accustomed harvesting grounds are Albertsons and Safeway and QFC, so how do you get people to shift their values and think about their food system in a different way? And he summed it up really easily with, it's really easy, you just go out there and you lift people up. That's all you have to do, is just lift people up. And so every day, it's sort of my mantra to wake up and hold that intention in the work that we do. And really, that's what we decided to move forward with the Food Sovereignty Project, just identifying people in the community who carry traditional food knowledge and passion for their foods within my own community and put them on a platform and help them to share their gifts. And out of that came this really beautiful outcome of promoting a sense of belonging in our community, of seeing people as teachers, where traditionally we would have done that on a daily basis. People would have been out fishing, harvesting, practicing their medicines, and now we've had this disruption in our food system and in our culture, but food brings us back. It brings us back to a place where we remember who we are and where we come from. So truly, for the Coast Salish people, food is a gift. It's our physical, mental, and spiritual medicine. And that means that when we're actively on the land in pursuit of wild game, or fishing the rivers, or cultivating prairie lands, or harvesting medicine with good intention, we are gifted. We're gifted with memories, both new and those of a distant past. And those memories help settle us in a sense of belonging and balance and generosity. And that's the medicine that we are all really after. The medicine that helps us to remember who we are and where we come from. So I was also taught that the Salmon people, and for Coast Salish people actually, the most powerful teaching is those that are given without a spoken word. So not like what I'm doing here today where I'm telling you what I know about Coast Salish foods and what it means to me and my people, but that we witness things on the landscape and then we ask ourselves how us pitiful human beings might be like the cedar tree, might be like all of the tree people, and how they stand together and take root and hold the earth together for those who come in the future, side by side in all their diversity and abundance. How it is that we might be like the Salmon people who, upon leaving their ancestral rivers, journey out into the ocean sea, exercise, go on this odyssey, tonify their bodies with these rich minerals and nutrients, and then return to their ancestral homes and give their life for the land and all that dwells on it. How it is that they are these relentless advocates to be medicine for the land. And so us Coast Salish witness this return and think how we, pitiful human beings, might be medicine for the land like the Salmon. That's how important this is for us. It is thousands of years, and most people will tell you since time began, that we organized our lives around the Salmon Nation, the Salmon people. And so when I heard of a corporation taking our cultural and intellectual sacred gifts and putting it in a laboratory, splicing it with an eel and an Atlantic salmon, three species that if they were ever in a tank together would never reproduce another third kind of species. I was really alarmed. And it's sort of this really hard hill to climb because the first word you say, genetic, people's eyes sort of glaze over. And then you have to get into the science of it to understand the difference between, you know, taking a seed and shaping it into a healthy species, or taking a seed and a seed from a different, completely different species and put that thing, those things together. And that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about an issue that was hands down, as soon as it was brought to my tribal council, unanimously voted against. So we passed a resolution in 2012 opposing the production of genetically engineered salmon. And that opened up the doorway to take it to the affiliated tribes of Northwest Indians, where it was also unanimously passed. And within 6 months, it was passed at the National Congress of American Indians. So it's safe to say all of Indian country had no argument and completely stood in solidarity against the production of this fish. And it was quite disturbing to hear that the FDA decided to move forward on that anyways, especially when they have a fiduciary obligation to speak with tribes, especially on issues that matter to them most, like our sacred food. So I've just been sort of sitting with this, and I'm not the kind of person that's gonna like go march on Washington, D.C., but I think it's really important that we also consider the teachings of the tree people here, how we collectively can stand together, can build an alliance, and build a beautiful landscape for those to come in the future, for people that we will never meet, and how we're gonna leave this place in a better way than we are leaving it, and that in a way that we inherited. So with that, I'm gonna, Heather told me she would tell me if I'm going on and on and on. Okay. I just would like to say how important our food system is, and that it's important to remember pre-contact, the Northwest region was the most largely populated, most densely populated, largely largest food system that was non-agricultural in the world at that time. And so this means we didn't have, you know, agriculture. We had a very well-maintained landscape that was based on a natural resources diet. The people that are from this place have traditional ecological knowledge that can help inform and shape a food system that can feed the future really well. We've been doing it for a long time. We're surrounded by abundance here in the Northwest. Over 300 different kinds of foods were eaten here pre-contact, which is very different from the standard American diet, which consists of about 18 to 20 different foods in a year. And diversity in your diet is really important, right? It honors all of the ecosystems. We know that healthy ecosystems are diverse ones. And so how do we take some of those traditional food system principles and incorporate them into our modern lives? And it's not very different from what you're hearing in the good food movement. Traditional foods are local foods. They're more local than local if you think about it. They are whole foods, which means they grow in nature. I don't know of any rivers of diet soda or shrubs of Lucky Charms, so you know, if you can't picture it growing in nature, don't eat it. But buying local, eating whole, that sort of takes the whole need to have a science degree to understand what's in your food out of the mix, and connects you to the inner desire inside of each and every one of us for wholeness. That's why when we eat this salmon today, you couldn't possibly gorge on an entire fish. You would just be comatose, right? Like Super Bowl Sunday comatose. It's because that food is so rich and full of medicine, the things that our body searches for. It's incredibly high in omega-3s and minerals and vitamins and vitamin D, all of the things that we need to survive and thrive on this land. And like Roger says, you know, we know what it takes. We know what it takes to save the salmon people, but we lack the will. And it's really important to remember how precious that food is and how worth caring about it is. And that you too are precious and you are also worth caring about. So with that, I'm probably gonna come up here a little bit later and brag about my fish cooks because I'm really proud of them. But I'm gonna let Pete come and speak. Thank you.
I don't know about you, but I've been watching these trailers for this movie about moving to Mars, and it scares the hell out of me. I mean, being in a situation where you're in like an enclosed tent and an asteroid comes in, and all of a sudden, poof, it's gone. This whole idea of colonizing is, in order to really colonize Mars, you would have to get all the microbes there. You'd have to let about 1 billion years pass. They'd have to generate oxygen so you had an atmosphere. I mean, it seems insane. It kind of evokes that song from, I think it was about 68, Gil Scott-Heron, Whitey's on the Moon. It was just like, this is kind of a crazy scheme. You know, how is this gonna deal with our situation? I think part of the problem is that the way our system, our corporate system, looks at animals is they look at animals like they're machines. You know, like they're little like Lego toys that you can adjust and you can put a piece in, put this in. We can go to Mars. We can bring a few little components, have a greenhouse. They're not machines. The Columbia River is not a machine, although it's treated like it's a machine. Everything is more than the sum of its parts. You know, everything has an intelligence that derives from being a whole organism or a whole animal. A part really can never comprehend the whole. We always have to have some humility because we know we didn't create ourselves. And we know that it's just hubris to think that we can understand all the implications when we radically intervene in nature or we try to recreate nature. When we try to create an artificial system that's going to replicate what nature's done over the last 4 billion years on the planet. I mean, you think of salmon, and who could design a system, a technical system, as efficient as salmon? I mean, here they hatch out in our rivers. They go out for 2 to 5 years out in the Pacific. They harvest all that work that the plankton are doing, and then they bring it right back to your doorstep. I mean, this is incredible. There's nothing that even comes close. And so, when I, last night, I went and I looked at the PR for this company that's making, that wants to sell genetically engineered salmon. And, they've got, they say it's sustainable. They say you eat this stuff, it'll actually take pressure off the wild fish. What else do they say? There was just, it's gonna deal with the problem of world hunger. I just about choked as I read this stuff. Who are these people? These people are not social activists that are worried about world hunger. When I looked at the board of directors of, I guess it was Aqua Bounty that's owned by Intrexon, they call themselves a genetically engineered conglomerate. Their background is basically different kinds of death industries. I'm talking pesticides, all kinds of GE plants. This is, salmon is the first GE animal, which we have contemplated releasing onto the planet. I mean, in the 1850s, Charles Darwin talked about the problems with exotic species, species that move into areas where they didn't evolve. And this is sort of like that on steroids. There's a big difference between agricultural animals or agricultural plants. You know, we know that the Western Hemisphere has been managed for buffalo, for salmon, all kinds of plants. For thousands and thousands and thousands of years, and yet we still have an integrated system. But what this is doing is it's throwing a new wild card into the system. So, okay, in my other life besides fishing, I spend since 1980, I've spent about 4 or 6 months a year on a 10-mile stretch of beach on Prince of Wales Island in southeast Alaska. And that's where my family's pretty much made its living. And then I went back to school, got a degree. And so now I'm up here at Seattle Central and I teach. Part of what I teach is about genes. And I just wanted to talk about genes for just a second. A lot of times genetic engineering or engineering in general is presented to us as a precise science. The guy that really first located genes was a guy named Gregor Mendel. He was a monk in I think it's now the Czech Republic, and he was breeding pea plants, and he found out that some were dominant and some were recessive. And this monastery that he was at, they were really into like mathematical formulas, and so he was trying to like blend together plants that would come out with a consistent mathematical formula. And so he found when he took tall pea plants and short pea plants, and he bred them together, and then he bred again, that the grandkids would come out 3-to-1 tall versus short, dominant and recessive. Except the only problem is the geneticists know this is like a dirty secret in genetics, that actually he cheated, you know, that it didn't quite come out 3-to-1. And so he had to kind of falsify the results a little bit. I mean, this is the basis of genetics. And the other thing is that Mendel would try to crossbreed a red flower and a white flower, he'd get a pink flower. And so a lot of the crossbreeding he was doing did not conform to the 3-to-1 formula. So from the very beginning of genetic research, we know that nature does not obey human categories and human laws, and we've actually had to fudge the nature from the very beginning. So, you know, genes are just little teeny sequences in the nuclei of your cell, and they code for certain kinds of things. What Mendel found was that one little gene, what he called a factor, actually coded for the height of a plant. But what we now know is that most of the genes in your body are not like Mendel's genes, where there's like one feature or there's one gene that codes for my shape of my nose or the color of my eyes. Actually, it's much more complex. What we now know is that in terms of genetics, there's what we call polygenic traits, where you've got a bunch of genes that collaborate together to produce skin color, things like that. And then you've also got situations in which one little gene is involved in a whole bunch of functions. Okay? So we've got, and now in genetics, we're finding out that what you're exposed to in the course of your life switches on or switches off your genes. So you have layers and layers and layers of complexity. And so with the genetic engineering industry like Monsanto or Aqua Bounty will tell you is, we're doing a very precise little intervention in nature. We're just gonna tweak this little thing here. We're just gonna put this little promoter from a eel that's gonna turn on the growth hormone from a king salmon, and we'll balloon out these Atlantic salmon in a very short period of time, no problem. Well, as anybody who knows genetics realizes, you don't know what's going to happen. You know, you don't know what the side effects are. I mean, essentially, you're creating a fish that cannot go to sleep. I mean, that's growing all the time. I mean, imagine if we as humans were genetically altered so we couldn't go to sleep. Things would start falling apart pretty fast. So then they say, well, we're doing this in isolated tanks. Right now it's gonna be in Panama. Of course, if you read their literature, they're bragging, we're gonna raise these things close to population centers in North America so we can reduce our carbon footprint because we're ecologically sophisticated. But you're depending on a whole bunch of government intervention to make sure that these genetically engineered fish do not get out in the wild ecosystem. Okay, and of course, I don't have an extraordinary amount of trust in our current government to enforce like FDA regulations or EPA regulations. In fact, precisely the opposite. They essentially want to destroy that regulation. So I think it's fairly safe to say that if you develop these organisms in isolation, they will eventually get out into the wild ecosystem. And you know, who knows what the results can be. There were some scientists at Purdue a few years ago that developed a hypothesis called the Trojan gene hypothesis. And it's been highly debated. And essentially what they argued was that if you engineer a fish to grow abnormally fast, it could actually spread in the wild and take over a lot of the ecosystems, and its genetics could replace the genetics of the naturally adapted fish, Trojan gene hypothesis. Who knows? I mean, we don't know. I'm not an expert on this, but I do know that these things don't necessarily follow. I mean, you look at our technology, look at Fukushima. I mean, I'm a fisherman. I know before I go fishing, I want to make sure my bilge pumps are working. I want to make sure the engine's in good shape and that there's float switches that'll tell me if I've got water coming in. But ultimately, all the fishing communities know that you get out in the water and you're playing the law of averages. You know, that you still may have something that you can't control that's going to happen. And Fukushima nuclear power, that's a good example of a technology that should not exist, because you shouldn't have a technology that, if it fails, can have wild consequences. And I think genetically engineered salmon falls in the same, it's part of the same mindset. So the table is set if this thing becomes widespread for it to get out of control. We don't have labeling laws in this country. We fought for labeling, 5 minutes I got? Okay. We fought for labeling laws for a long time. It was called country of origin labeling, and it got repealed by the U.S. Congress last year, you know, as a result of pressure from meat producers in Canada and Mexico. They sued the United States under the trade agreement. You know, we had a state initiative in Washington State. What was that, 3 years ago? 3 years ago, I know Heather was heavily involved in it. My little fish company was. And of course, the Coca-Cola, Pepsi, might as well name names, they illegally infused $100 million into the election here and barely won it, you know. So we don't have ways of labeling genetically engineered fish. Plus, there have been nationwide studies done of wild fish being served at restaurants. Three quarters of the farm salmon are mislabeled as wild salmon nationally. So we're opening a Pandora's box, you know, as we've been doing here for quite a while in our culture, and we need to put it back in the box. You know, when I talk about farm salmon, a lot of these things about genetically engineered salmon are like farm salmon on steroids in terms of disease proliferation. It's only a matter of time, given capitalist economics, that if GE salmon is that much cheaper to produce, it'll end up in the farms out in the wild, you know, in British Columbia and here in Washington State. We've got alternatives. I mean, if we're really concerned about sustaining the North Pacific ecosystem and sustaining the cultures that live from salmon, there are lots of good alternatives. Number one, restoring the habitat, which, you know, if we didn't have the tribes out there fighting for that, we'd be in very tough shape right now. In Southeast Alaska, where I fish, we have cooperative aquaculture associations where we've developed really good hatchery technology that we use in barren inlets that don't conflict with the wild fish. It's probably 40% of our production up there. That's another alternative. We have remote release sites. The Elwha, what's just happening on the Elwha, this is a great example. That's an economic development project as well as the restoration of the salmon. These are all alternatives. So what do we do? What do we do about all this stuff, you know, besides being freaked out? Sometimes I think everybody is, we paint the picture so grim that all we want to do is just go out myself and drink a beer. But I think, you know, we've got to do a bunch of stuff. I mean, A, we have to take back the democracy. That's really clear. We have to take back the democracy. I mean, that's really where it starts. And if we're shut out, you know, then we just take direct democracy, like what's happened to the Dakota Access Pipeline, you know? What the Lummies have done in terms of preserving Cherry Point, you know, it's direct action. And I go back to this book by Michael Pollan called Omnivore's Dilemma, or maybe it's another one called In Defense of Food. And he's got a couple of rules of thumb for your personal self-defense. He says, number one, don't eat anything with more than 5 ingredients in it. And number two, he says, don't eat anything your grandmother wouldn't recognize. And maybe today we should say, don't eat anything that your great-grandmother wouldn't recognize. So anyways, I'm honored to be part of your gathering today. And there's some great coho salmon that's wonderfully cooked waiting for you out there. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Steve Mashuda. I'm an attorney with Earth Justice. We're a nonprofit environmental law firm. It kind of makes me nervous to know that I'm the only thing standing between everyone in this room and lunch, but I will try and keep my marks pretty brief. I've been asked to tell you a little bit about our lawsuit against the Food and Drug Administration for its approval of genetically engineered salmon, which has been talked about already. But before I do that, I want to mention a concept that I'll come back to in a moment. And I want everybody to picture what we all know about the life cycle of wild salmon. The wild salmon who are born in the gravel in mountain streams, who rear in those streams, who migrate out to the ocean, who spend a few years feeding in the nutrient-rich North Pacific, and then coming home to those streams to feed everything from people to bears to the trees that are on the sides of those streams. Those wild salmon are the really, I mean, it's hard to overemphasize how much of a key part of this entire landscape those salmon are and how they're interwoven into everything that we are and everything that we do. Now, I want you to think about that for a moment and then think about a very different life cycle, if you could call it that, for the genetically engineered salmon. What FDA approved in November of 2015 was for a company to be able to grow eggs, genetically engineered eggs, sterilize them, or at least try to, in a facility on Prince Edward Island on the east coast of Canada. Those eggs, those fish, because I don't know that we should really call them salmon, but those fish will be taken from there by plane to Panama, where they will be raised in tanks in the mountains of Panama to adulthood. They will be processed, turned into fillets, put on a plane, and flown back to your local supermarket or your local restaurant. That's the life cycle, if you could call it a life, of this organism. Now, I would think about that for a minute and think about the differences between the wild salmon life cycle and that life cycle, and we'll come back to that in a second. But in this lawsuit, we're representing the Quinault Indian Nation and 11 consumer fishing and environmental groups. So we're working closely with the Center for Food Safety, which has been at the forefront of these issues. We're co-counseling this case with them. But we are also representing everybody from fishermen from Southeast Alaska and along the Pacific coast to Canadian fishermen and Canadian groups who are concerned about the future of wild Atlantic salmon, which is, everyone knows, an extraordinarily precarious species on the east coast of the United States. There's about 700 to 1,000 fish that come back to rivers in the U.S. of wild Atlantic salmon every year. We're working with environmental groups who are concerned about the impacts that these fish would have if they get out into the wild. And Pete talked about this a little bit, and I'm always reminded, it's almost a cliche at this point to think about Jurassic Park, where, you know, the Jeff Goldblum has this great speech about life finds a way. And the approval process that FDA did for these fish ignores that very fundamental and pretty easy to understand concept. The agency here applied a 1938 law, the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, which is an example of, you know, again, great New Deal legislation that was intended to protect consumers. It was intended to protect consumers from things like drugs that were used in animal production. So think giving penicillin to pigs. What's the effect on the animal? What's the effect on the people who are eating that animal? Very well-intentioned law, of course, as with most New Deal legislation. But it was never intended to regulate genetically engineered animals. This was never, anybody who says that this was in any congressperson's mind in 1938 when we passed the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act is on something, because this is not a law that was created to manage this kind of thing. This is not an animal drug. This is an animal. They have created a new animal that did not exist but for the human hand. It's not just giving a shot to livestock. So the focus of our case is on the environmental impacts of the production of this fish. So chief among those, I think, as Pete said as well, escape. What happens when these fish get out? Because they will. We can tell ourselves a different story if we want to, for as long as we want to, but they're going to get out. And part of that comes back to the process of raising these that I mentioned before. If anybody believes that the long-term business model and the business plan of genetically engineered salmon producers is to raise them in Canada and fly them to Panama and then fly them back to the United States, and anybody thinks you can make a profit on that in the long term, we should go up and maybe talk to some folks at the business school and see what they think about that. That's not the long-term plan. The plan has always been to expand this, to expand these egg sales to other places, to fish farms that are existing now out there. They want to market this stuff to every salmon farmer across the world. So everywhere from Chile to Puget Sound to British Columbia to Norway to the east coast of Canada in the range of Atlantic salmon. So we don't have a perfect system. These fish are going to they're going to expand, and at some point it is highly likely that they're going to get out into the ecosystem. 30%, up to 30% in some rivers in British Columbia, of the salmon in those rivers are escaped Atlantic salmon from fish farms on the coast of British Columbia, just as a small example. So what happens when these fish are among those escapees? FDA didn't look at that, because FDA's model is what's the effect of the very small four corners of a document presented to us? What's the impact on human health, and what are the impacts to the environment of just this thing that somebody told us that they're going to do? And the thing that they were told about was, again, this kind of Rube Goldberg model of raising the fish in Canada and Panama and then flying them back in the United States. They didn't look at that expansion. They didn't look at the effects of that. And that's really at the heart of our case. Experts who actually think about this stuff, who've spent careers thinking about what happens when genetically modified organisms of any kind, but especially animals, get out, warned the FDA over and over again that you needed to at least start coming to grips with the impacts to the environment of what would happen if these fish would escape. And FDA said, well, no, they won't escape. And that's where they stopped. We have laws on the books in this country that tell agencies that they need to look before they leap. That's the National Environmental Policy Act. It's one of the laws at the heart of our lawsuit. Looking before you leap involves doing that. It doesn't mean jumping and hoping that there's a cushion at the bottom to catch you or a pool of water to catch you at the bottom. It means you look and you check. You don't just make assumptions about things, and that's where FDA went off the rails on this one. Just to give you a very quick update of where things are, we filed this case back in March, almost a year ago, and we are still fighting with the Food and Drug Administration about the evidence and what we can have access to in order to prosecute the case. So we have been, in a very lawyerly way, we have been fighting about documents for the past 6 months or so, trying to make sure that we have access to all the information that FDA had access to when it did this approval so that we can prosecute this challenge. In the meantime, Pete very accurately mentioned that there is no labeling for genetically engineered salmon. There's nothing, if it were to show up in Costco, Costco's not selling it, sorry. If it were to show up somewhere tomorrow, nobody would have to tell you what you're eating. In the end of 2015, Senator Murkowski from Alaska, Senator Cantwell from Washington, and a number of others banded together and tacked on an amendment to a spending bill that said FDA cannot allow the import of genetically engineered salmon until it develops a comprehensive consumer labeling system. FDA has not been very forthcoming as to where they are in the development of that comprehensive labeling system. We know very strongly that those who produce these fish do not want that labeling system. And so there is a sort of de facto safety valve at the moment, and who knows how long it will last because of this amendment on a spending bill that prevents the importation of GE salmon until that spending bill expires, which could be as soon as March or April. I'm not going to hazard any guesses as to what Congress is going to do. But if that goes away, then the company would be free to start importing this stuff in the United States. Hopefully, and that's one of the things that I would encourage folks to do, contact their elected officials, let them know that they care about this, that if this is an issue that comes up again, that we of course expect all of them to vote to extend that ban for as long as need be, so that we can at least have some idea of what's on our plates. Just want to close with a short observation. There's a lot about this case and the millions of dollars that have gone into the development of this technological answer to a environmental problem. And when I step back from all of the details and whether or not documents are confidential and whether or not we have access to them or whether FDA followed the procedures and the law, to me this case is really about what's the future of our food, what's the future of wild salmon, particularly in the Pacific Northwest, but everywhere that they live, and that's Atlantic salmon as well as Pacific salmon. We have spent millions of dollars, again, on the human impulse to fix something, but doing it wrong. Yesterday, I was kind of reminded of this because we had sun for the first time in Lord knows how long. And by the end of the day, I was having trouble breathing. I have seasonal allergies, and it didn't occur to me until about 6 o'clock at night that maybe the reason I was sneezing and that my eyes were itching was that the sun had woken something up out there and that there was a lot of pollen in the air. And the first thing I did, I rushed and I grabbed a pill and I took the pill because as soon as I thought it was allergies, oh, I have a pill for this, I can fix it. But when I step back and think about what's the root cause of my allergies, what's the root cause of, you know, why I'm reaching for a pill, it's because we live in the city and for the trees that we have in the city are mostly male because we've had policies in place for a number of years, and some of them, you know, with good reason, not to plant too many female trees because we don't want fruit falling all over the sidewalks everywhere. And so there are, you know, you look at the City of Seattle code and it encourages and in some places mandates, especially if you're planting in your parking strip, that you plant male trees so that we don't have that problem. But what that has created is an environment that is artificially full of pollen that drives people like me crazy every spring. But I think about my solution to that on a very individual level is to reach for a pill. Well, for wild salmon, we have degraded and destroyed and hammered the habitat and the natural environment that these fish survive in for 100 years in this part of the world, more than that on the East Coast. And our solution to that should be to fix the environment. If we put all the money that we were throwing into genetically engineered salmon into habitat restoration or dam removal, we could do a lot better for the future of wild fish and for all of us than if we just throw that money into what is the, in some ways, the genetically engineered salmon are the equivalent of the allergy pill. We're just putting something out there. We're not addressing the fundamental problem. Let's just cover it up with one more technological fix. So with that, I want to leave you to think about that and enjoy some wild salmon for lunch. Thank you very much.
Valerie, if you can come up. So we are rolling here with our program. We're going to do three questions and have our speakers respond and then see if we have more time. We're kind of limited on time, but just heard all the salmon's not ready, so whatever. We'll just keep adjusting, figuring this out. But first, I just want to encourage you. We don't have an event like this only to educate and inspire and eat delicious food. We want to organize, and in order to organize with you and help generate the pressure that's needed for change, we need your information. So just make sure, we'll pass these around during lunch, just make sure that you've signed up if you haven't already. So Valerie, can you come up? And I'm going to ask for three questions. We're going to have three questions all at once and then ask our speakers to respond to all three. And if you could please, like, I really encourage folks who I call on now to ask a question, and this isn't a time, you know, sometimes you have comments as well, but we just have very limited time. So three concise questions would be very appreciated. And Valerie, where are you, my dear? Valerie Seagrest, we need you. Valerie, does anybody see her? Can you look for her? Thanks. Just want to make sure she has a chance to hear the questions. Okay, so I see a hand, and if you could stand up and speak loudly, that would be great. Thank you. So the question is, what exact action to take to pressure members of Congress to extend the ban. So that's exactly the reason we want you to sign up, because that's the kind of thing that Community Alliance for Global Justice will follow up with everyone about. But I also will welcome Steve to respond to that in just a second. So the next, another question, please. Anybody else? I know there's some. Any kind of question is welcome. So are there other companies other than this Aquabana company involved in genetically engineering fish? Uh-huh. Maybe you could speak as well to the fact that salmon is the beginning of many, many animals to come. Great, thank you. Another question? Is there concern that the company will take a stance similar to Monsanto, that the GE salmon is their intellectual property and they could sue, you know, if the salmon is harvested against their proposed way of doing it? So if all three of you could come up and maybe just each of you could respond to whichever parts are most relevant to you, that would be great.
So on the contacting your elected officials, so I don't have the bill numbers and things in front of me to reference the old legislation, but I think the most important thing they need to hear is that you support, you know, the ban on importation of genetically engineered salmon up until and unless it is fully labeled and disclosed. You don't need to say that you would support it if it were fully labeled and disclosed, of course, but that is the basis of the ban. So I think elected officials hearing that you support the current moratorium is very important, because when that moratorium comes up for renewal, they'll know they have the support.
Well, the Europeans do not permit genetically engineered organisms in Europe. They follow an ecological principle called the precautionary principle, where you do not introduce something until it's been absolutely vetted over generations of time. I think there is some European investment in Intrex or whatever the holding company is for Aqua Bounty. So the United States, we're sort of like the Petri dish in terms of this whole GE thing. We're definitely an outlier, I would say. Yeah.
There is a bit of a concern, I think, for tribes who run hatcheries and the whole genetic situation that's happening. Does everyone understand I feel like that question is also a learning opportunity. Does everyone understand what that means? I don't want to assume. So, like, if you're cross-pollinating across crops, what has happened in the past is companies like Monsanto, who have a genetic corn variety, that corn has cross-pollinated with another crop, and they were able to take over that corn crop. They were able to take over the land and the seed and the family that owned that crop for a very long time. So the question is, could that happen here? And when it comes to tribes and all the investment that they put into hatcheries to make sure that salmon actually return to our rivers, theoretically, there is a seed variety there. And that has yet to been discussed with us, because nothing's been discussed with us at all. So yeah, that's a concern, definitely.
Just to follow up on that, there's a long history with Monsanto. And they have gene police that actually they will investigate farmers' crops to see if any of their genetically engineered product has drifted over and is being raised. And they've actually prosecuted farmers for that. So, there is a precedent for that. I know when I was growing up here, when I was about 18, I did a little beech logging. And I remember when the logs would come up, they'd have the Weyerhaeuser stamp on the end of it, and we would always saw that off first.
I want to just respond quickly to the question about whether there are other GE fish in the pipeline, so to speak.
And companies,
yes. So the answer is undoubtedly yes, and the reason I have to say the word undoubtedly before that is that we don't really know. And this is back to a problem with the way that the FDA is regulating these things or purporting to regulate them. There's no, because of confidentiality, and if you think about, think about human drugs for a minute, if somebody's working on a gangbuster new, pharmaceutical thing, they don't tell anybody about it until they're ready to. Well, because this is the FDA and because we're regulating these as animal drugs, the same thing applies. We don't know. You can't go to FDA and say, hey, how many applications have you got in the last 10 years for genetically engineered animals, and where are they in the process? They can't tell you. The law says that that's confidential business information that we can't get. And so we don't really know the answer. We know for sure that there are other genetically engineered animals. There's rumors that we have a genetically engineered brown trout somewhere in the mix that's engineered to grow faster as well. But we don't know where that is in the process, when it'll be approved. We find out at the end. It's like a bad soap opera or something, where you just really learn what happens or what the impacts are after the action is pretty much already taken. And that's another problem with our existing laws. These were not, I can't emphasize this enough, the laws that we have on the books were not designed to regulate this kind of thing. And the most charitable reading is that, you know, well-intentioned people are trying to do the best they can with the tools they have, but we've kind of moved beyond that because the tools we have are manifestly not up to the task. And so it's time for trying to take this out of a box it was never intended to fit in.
Okay, so first the bad news. The rain is making it difficult to cook the salmon, so we're delaying 15 more minutes, but we promise we'll feed you at 12:45. So that means we have a little bit more time for Q&A. So we're gonna take three more questions right now, and then we're gonna do our closing call to action before lunch, and then we'll do a final round of thank yous before the end of the event. So, are there three more questions? There's one here. So under trade agreements such as NAFTA, under NAFTA is the famous chapter 11, oh my gosh, or 12. Anyway, foreign companies can sue governments for loss of projected or expected revenue. It's one of the most outrageous things and one of the main reasons we organized to oppose U.S. trade agreements. So the question is, could these efforts to ban GE salmon, like could Aqua Bounty then try to sue the government over this? Since it's a transnational company, I'm not even totally sure who would be suing who, but these guys will know. Great, thank you. So another question? So the legal battle that they've been discussing it mostly in terms of environmental law, and she's wondering if Valerie could speak to whether treaty law is being used to try to prevent GE salmon. One more question? Where is GMO salmon being, where is the production of GE salmon taking place? Is that your question? Okay, so is BC the other only place where this is taking place so far? Great, thank you. So we'll now take quick responses before bringing up Simone. Do you have a question? I'm sorry. Okay.
So we do need to educate ourselves and become involved with this because we don't. These decisions
Could everyone hear that? Thank you. Looking in the front. Sounds like, for the most part, making a very important point about how this GE salmon is part of a larger issue that DNA and life can be patented, and that there's all these different levels that needs to be fought against. Thank you.
So I just want to take real quick first the question about British Columbia. So just in case, because sometimes I confuse East and West when I'm talking. So right now there are Atlantic salmon farms in British Columbia. Those farms are not raising genetically engineered Atlantic salmon. The fear, of course, and you know, eventually that is the marketing plan, is to be able for this company to be able to sell eggs to the farmers in British Columbia or in Norway or wherever else Atlantic salmon are farmed in order to do that. So they are raising them in Canada, however, on the East Coast, on Prince Edward Island. That's where the facility that sort of manufactures these fish exists.
There's a huge movement in British Columbia challenging the fish farm industry. You know, there's been some good science. In fact, there was a paper last week published establishing pretty widespread viruses over, they measured one farm over time, and they're finding lots of viruses. There's just big, big movements to try to put these things out of the water, get them out of the water. And the alternative is to essentially go back to wild fish, and this is not utopian. I mean, that's what the state of Alaska did. Alaska banned net pen aquaculture, and they're doing just fine. 2 years ago, they harvested 250 million wild salmon. So, I mean, this is not a utopian solution. It's just let nature take its course, restore the habitat, and things will come back. You know, the industry, the net pen industry, came out of Norway initially, and they've had disaster after disaster. They've had to poison entire rivers over there when they had exotic diseases and parasites coming in. Then it went to Ireland, and they had disasters with other fish there, like their sea trout, things coming out of the pen, the pens amplifying diseases. And then Chile. And Chile is a big, big producer. And one thing I would point out, I was just reading some Chilean environmental papers last night. They estimate that it takes about 8.5 pounds of wild anchovies, mackerel, to make 1 pound of farm salmon. So this is not feeding world hunger. It's actually a restriction. It's a loss of protein for their local people down there. So. But anyway, I just wanted to make the major point that Alaska has been proactive and has taken other routes to augment wild salmon production, and they're doing well.
There is a question about treaty law, which I'm going to be really, like, I'm a nutritionist, so I'm not a lawyer, but I'm learning a lot about it. And one of the things that our lawyers have, you know, talk to me about, because we drafted our resolution together, when it comes to treaties of this land, and even just the conversation that happened when treaty times were happening, you know, it was always about access to elk, salmon, berries, roots, cedar and fir trees. It was always about that, because the Coast Salish people, we know that our oral stories tell us that when these foods cease to exist, then so do we as a people. That we may move and breathe on this land, but that we will be nobody without our foods. So one of the really helpful sort of, you know, things that they've told me is that the treaties are actually the most powerful environmental legislation of this land, which is probably why it's being framed, you know, in an environmental way. And I do want to just sort of break down, you know, into digestible pieces here some of the most alarming issues that we're bringing your attention to. And that's that this has never been done before, right? And that goes back to Pete and what he was touching on with the precautionary principle and unintended consequences, that little research has been done on this, like we are all the research project, that they cannot really guarantee contamination because they always say that, but it happens anyways. And that there is, this company is not, does not believe in transparency. So they do not want it to be labeled because they think it's too difficult for consumers to understand, which is kind of rude. And that it's not that nutritious. It's actually, being marketed on the back of a legacy of a wild fish that is really nutritious. And so you're, as a consumer, looking at this product thinking that you're going to get the same health benefits when they actually don't have your health in mind. And then to what the gentleman in the back was speaking to, that this is, that we are now making salmon is property of a corporation, which is very, very alarming. So I'm going to hand it over to Steve, because he has talked with Quinault about joining the actual lawsuit piece.
Oh, and then, sorry, is that? Thanks. And just on this issue of the treaty claims and as at least as it pertains to the Quinault Indian Nation, which is our client in this case. A couple of things. There's a few different levels of what I would call sacred obligations that we as the United States have to First Nations. And the first of those, I think as Valerie touched on, is a very simple one. It's called consultation, and it's a very, it's talking to people before you do things. This is a obligation that the federal government violates with alarming frequency, because they don't talk to people who are affected, and that is very much the case here, as with everything else. As Valerie mentioned, I think before, there has been no consultation with the Northwest Natives. There has been no consultation with the Canadian First Nations, for example. This is not something that anybody talked about before it was done. And again, this gets back to some of the fundamental problems with our laws. We don't have, beyond that point, we don't really have a claim that is based on the Quinault Indian Nation's treaty right to harvest salmon. There are a bunch of different reasons for that, but I think the ones that are most prominent is that many of the impacts that we're talking about here are covered by other statutes and other laws that we're more familiar with dealing with as well. So.
All right, let's thank our speakers for their answers and our questioners for the questions. So we're gonna have lunch in just a minute. We're gonna start serving in about 5 minutes. It's not all gonna be ready then, so you might have to go through the line twice, but it's also, there's a lot of people here, so it's gonna take a while to get through the line. But we'll take about half an hour for lunch. Regardless of where we're at with stuff at 1:15, we'll come back to do our closing remarks and call to action and thank yous. So just wanted to first say what we're having for lunch. So we're having kale salad, and it's actually our favorite recipe from our cookbook. 1 year we called for recipes at our big annual dinner called the Strengthening Local Economies Everywhere Dinner, and it was really cool because the woman that we invited to give the keynote that year, Abba Ifioma, who's with the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network, who's doing some of the most amazing food justice work in the U.S., donated this recipe, and it just ended up being something that we use for every event because it's delicious. It's actually raw kale, but it's sort of cooked down by the enzymes with the Bragg's and vinegar and stuff that are the dressing. So we're having that kale salad, and then Valerie taught us how to make Salish spring soup, which includes nettles, which she harvested this morning. So there will be, the salad is vegan, and we'll have soup that's vegan, and then those of you who want salmon, we'll also have soup with salmon. And then there will also be salmon for everyone to taste. And you know, there's a little bit for everyone. You're not gonna get like a big portion, but I'm sure you're not surprised. So that's what we're having for lunch, just simple. Like I said, they're gonna be putting it out at 12:45, so just in a couple minutes, I wanna invite folks with kids or elderly people, those who need a little bit more time to get through the line to please go first and lining up at the table, and just make sure to make a line on both sides of the table. If there's lots of seats available in the room, especially at the front, so if you need some place to sit down at the table, crowd in, get to know one another, get to know who's at the table that you don't know already, that's a great thing to do with as well. So enjoy, before we do that, Valerie, are we gonna hear? Okay. Did you want to? Okay. So that's all for now. We'll come back in a little bit. Enjoy lunch.
I'm a fisherman and a cook. It's just something that we do often back home at our homes and at our gatherings, and it was an honor to come here and to prepare a meal for you guys. And thank you for coming. Thank you for remembering our salmon. And thank you for standing up and resisting the genetically modified salmon. That's about it. So enjoy, have a good day. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Leonard Moses, and I have been cooking fish and everything else all my life, and I'm glad that you guys loved it. Thank you.
I am TJ Molina, Muckleshoot tribal member. My native name's Chihuatio, and I enjoy doing this, and that's why I came out here, because I really wanted to cook some fish. So hope you guys all enjoy it. Thank you. I trust you.
I'm Tyson Simmons. I'm from Muckleshoot also, and I came out here to help Louie cook fish for you guys. Hope you guys liked it.
My name is Travis English. I work for Loki Fish Company. I'm their chef over there. And with the guidance of Valerie providing the recipe, I made the nettle soup and the kale salad. So thank you for coming out today.
And I have one more person. I just started a youth food planning council. Ooh, so excited. And I have these like little rock stars that exist in our community. One of them is here today, and she'd like to share just a couple words with you for a couple minutes. But first, we're gonna have our canoe family sing us a song to honor all of them. So thank you.
OCM, they're all in there eating, so they're gonna be in here in just a minute. Right? But Willard Bill Jr. Titsta, Buckleshoot Abshed. My name is Willard Bill Jr. I'm also an enrolled member of the Muckleshoot Indian Tribe and the cultural program director for the tribe. So I get to work with Valerie every day as honor. Louis is actually my boss, but he's being real humble up here today as our council member. You got to hear my great-grandfather, Roger Fernandez, from the Lorelwa Tribe earlier today. That's a little joke here. He'll get me back later. But it's always important to remember, and I have quite a few of my family members up here and cousins. We are direct descendants of the people of this land. And our ancestor, Tshiehod, was the last free Indian to live on Lake Washington. We trace that lineage to here. We hold this in sacred space. We also honor those elders that helped build this house. And so Virginia Cross, our tribal chair, who went to school here in the early 70s. Mr. Leo LeClaire, that came here and went to law school. My father and my kid's grandfather, Dr. Willard Beale Sr., whose name you see out there, who worked here in the College of Education with Emmett Oliver. And of course, our late uncle, Julian Argyll, you see the honor, the blanket out there in the hallway for him that paved that way for a lot of us to be here. My oldest is now a freshman here and helping continue that work and that legacy. So we always honor this space. But we wanted to honor our cooks and our fishermen here today. You often hear us being called a casino tribe. And we own a casino. It's one of our businesses. And we appreciate it if you come down. Because I got two more that I got to put through college. So if you come out, you don't call it losing. You just call it a donation. And so when you're putting that money into the machine there, you come have some fun. And we appreciate that. But we are a people of the water, people of the salmon. These men have grown up since they were young being trained in this way. And they do this in a good way. It's not just just like a barbecue where they come out. They've been trained in these traditional ways, and they bring that medicine to you. And when they cook that, they put that medicine into that food to feed not just your body, but to feed your spirit. And that's how serious they take it. So you see them out there joking around, but that's part of that medicine that they're bringing to you. We're going to share our feast song and to honor these cooks here and then the work that you're all doing today and keeping those salmon wild. We'll see you.
Thank you once again. I'd like to introduce Ms. Nevaeh Johnson, who is on the Muckleshoot Youth Food Planning Council and goes to the tribal school. She is in ninth grade, going on 30-something. It's really awesome. I love her very much. And when she was interviewing for this position, because we chose people to come really thoughtfully think through food policy in our community, and we wanted to hear from the youth first. Her question to me was, what can I do to be awesome at this? Like, you're hired. So I'm gonna let her speak. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nevaeh Johnson, and I am a descendant at the Muckleshoot Indian tribe, and it is a pleasure to be here, first off, and it is a pleasure working with Valerie, because she is such a wonderful woman. Working with the Food Council is like a blessing, like a three-in-one blessing. For one, I get to learn things, and education is key. And my education can't be destroyed. And once I learn something, I will never unlearn it. And I can pass it on to my kids, and my kids' kids, and my kids' kids' kids, you know? And number two is I get to help people today. No matter how young I am, I can still help people like you guys. And it doesn't just have to be my kids. It can be someone else's mom or someone else's kids. You know, I like to help people. And another thing is just working with Valerie, because she is such a wonderful woman. And I really, really love her. And she's taught me a lot through these past couple of weeks. And it is such a blessing. Coming into the Food Council, I didn't expect to be standing up here talking in front of a whole bunch of people. I just thought, like, we're just gonna learn stuff, do some research, but it's so much more than that. And it's not about just doing research or learning about things. It's about our lives and our eating habits and what makes us stronger and what doesn't. So it is truly a blessing, and I just wanted to say thank you for letting me be here. Thanks.
Greetings, everyone. What an amazing and delicious event this has been. How are y'all feeling right now? You feeling nourished, well-fed, everybody eat really well? I'm sure people have also been learning something today, and I hope that we're all feeling energized to also take action. So my name is Simone Adler. I'm the organizing director with Community Alliance for Global Justice. And it's been a real honor and privilege to help organize this event today and raise awareness about the threats of genetically engineered salmon. And you're all here because you know that we need to protect wild salmon and their cultural and ecological importance, as Valerie, Pete, and Steve put so eloquently earlier. So I wanted to share a bit about what we can also do right now to take action and build off this beautiful momentum we're creating together today. And as Valerie brought up, we need to create and generate the political will. And like Pete said, it starts with bringing democracy back to the people. So this is why we organize, and we're so glad that everyone here is in this room to support that. So here in Washington State, we have the opportunity to boldly increase public awareness and legislative and congressional support to keep GE salmon out of our waters and off of our grocery shelves. And if we can get a resolution passed in Washington State Legislature that strongly opposes the FDA's approval of genetically engineered salmon, we would increase the pressure for the FDA to reverse that approval. And if it still goes forward, to require labeling so consumers know what is in their fish and their food. Wouldn't that be a powerful act to do? Yeah. So there is precedent for this. And I know Steve also touched on some of this earlier, too. Just last month, the Alaska State Legislature introduced a resolution to the Alaska House Fisheries Committee that opposes the FDA's approval and furthermore urges that Congress enact legislation that requires prominent labeling on genetically engineered products, including Aqua Bounty, Aqua Advantage, genetically engineered salmon, with the words genetically modified on the product's packaging. And our senators, Maria Cantwell and Patty Murray, have already demonstrated their strong opposition to GE salmon here in Washington and federally. So we know there's already support in Congress. In December 2015, right after the FDA approved Aqua Advantage salmon, Cantwell made a statement, and we want to thank her for her leadership on that, condemning the FDA's approval and strongly supporting the requirement and development of labeling guidelines. So we hope that we can continue to count on her for support of a state resolution here in Washington. And we also want to thank Senator Murray for his previous efforts. Even before the FDA went ahead and approved GE salmon, Murray co-signed a bill in 2011 that would have prevented the GE salmon from being approved. And obviously that was lost, of course, but it illustrates that our senators are on our side, which is really important and great. So back in 2002, in fact, a permanent ban on transgenic salmon production in Washington State fish farms was approved, but there's loopholes here around genetically engineered salmon not fitting into that transgenic definition, and this ban only is applying to aquaculture fish farms, not state waters. So we can work toward a resolution that would firm up these definitions and make sure GE salmon production is not allowed in our state. Another precedent in a West Coast state happened in California. In 2014, even before the FDA's approval, the state of California passed a bill completely banning the production of GE salmon in California waters over concerns about the impact of these fish on native wild salmon population. So we know that right now in this political climate, it's ever more important for states to step up legislatively and symbolically against federal ruling, like the approval of GE salmon. And with strong resolutions in Washington, California, and Oregon, we can show that Western states are taking the lead and then fight at the federal level. And I also want to acknowledge the importance of grassroots work outside of congressional and legislative of action. In 2015, after a joint campaign with Friends of the Earth and a coalition of 30 other consumer groups that Community Alliance for Global Justice took part in, 60 supermarket chains and 9,500 stores nationwide made a public commitment to not sell GE salmon on their shelves. And yeah, it's amazing. Some of those stores are really big names like Costco, Kroger, Safeway, Trader Joe's, and Whole Foods. That's really huge. And Community Alliance for Global Justice activists played a major role in convincing Costco to commit to not selling GE salmon, including circulating a petition that received over 50,000 signatures, which we creatively delivered to Costco in Seattle. So we know that there is both consumer, retailer, and distributor support as well to keep GE salmon off the shelves. And we know what's possible. We can mobilize our community to urge our legislators. We want to pass a state resolution that opposes the FDA's approval of GE salmon and calls on Congress to require labeling. This would put us in the right direction for an ultimate ban on the production of GE salmon in Washington and would send a strong signal as one of the states most impacted by the introduction of salmon here, as we've learned more about today. So we can take action to do this. Who's in? Yeah. And on that note, if you haven't yet signed in our sign-in sheets, please do so we can keep you updated on the next steps, which could possibly be a letter-writing campaign to our legislators or other actions toward a resolution. So make sure you sign up and put in your email address and zip code and information like that. I also am very excited to announce another way to keep this awareness building going really strong. In partnership with Valerie and the Muckleshoot Food Sovereignty Project, we are going to be creating a short educational film about the issues of GE salmon. And we're very thrilled to be working with Katie Jennings of New Canoe Media, who has extensive background creating documentary films with Native tribes. So this is a really exciting project we're embarking on. And it will be a short call to action. And the planning is just getting started. So we will be calling for support to raise the necessary funds and also help with distribution of the film. So please reach out if you're interested in helping with this project. And finally, I wanted to leave you with a bit of an inspiring idea. So we know it's really necessary to strengthen the connections and highlight the shared struggles faced by both community-based fishermen and family and small farmers. This is why our partners, Northwest Atlantic Marine Alliance and National Family Farm Coalition, are rolling out a campaign called the Declaration of Interdependence. The purpose of this campaign is to show the commonalities between community-based fishermen and family farmers and highlight their essential roles in providing healthy, responsibly produced foods and supporting local economies. And ultimately, we hope this campaign will arrive at several policy solutions as well. Corporate dominance of our social, economic, and food systems has led to the economic injustices inherent in our current price structures, in our market for both community-based fishermen and family farmers. And rural and minority fishing and farming communities have been marginalized in these policies that affect fishing and farming. So the Declaration of Interdependence aims to achieve long-term fixes to these policies while also making the point that food is a powerful connector for bridging gaps between people. And we must recognize our interdependence as food consumers, farmers, fishers, and eaters. We're all a part of that. As a member of the National Family Farm Coalition and partners with the North Atlantic Marine Alliance, Community Alliance for Global Justice is supporting this interdependence campaign. And we hope that the launch of the Declaration of Interdependence will strengthen these connections towards food and fisheries sovereignty. And lastly, I just want to close out with some thank yous. Especially, I want to thank the canoe families who were so lucky to have here with us and share their song and beautiful performance. I want to acknowledge also the incredible speakers and presenters for sharing their stories and their wisdom and experiences with us today. So to Valerie Seagrass, the founder of Muckleshoot Food Sovereignty Project, it's been an honor and privilege to organize this event with you, and thank you so much for your work in bringing the issue of GE salmon to the forefront of as a native rights issue. To Pete Knutson of Loki Fish Company, thank you for your activism as a fisher standing up for the protection of salmon habitat and sustainable fisheries. To Steve Mashuda, the attorney at Earth Justice, thank you for your integral leadership efforts in the lawsuit against the FDA. Justice Bill, thank you so much for your song and prayer that opened this event in such a ceremonious and deeply connecting way. And thanks for organizing the Canoe Families event to take place after this, so stick around. To Roger Fernandez, thank you for your storytelling that brings us to the core of why this is important. And we also want to thank Central Co-op and Muckleshoot Seafood Products for donating the salmon and food items. And to the Muckleshoot Tribe Charity Fund for providing Community Alliance for Global Justice with a generous grant to educate about GE salmon and Northwest Native resistance. And also want to thank all of the amazing volunteers and interns who've helped us out so much. To Jana Lafferty, who's been volunteering with the Food Justice Project and is doing her PhD research on these issues. So thank you for your tireless support and of this campaign and your excellent research. To Mandy Edwards, Johanna Lundell, and Chloe Landrell, thank you for your great work as interns with us, and you've helped out so much. And for all the volunteers who helped prep food for the event, especially Louie and Travis and the fish cooks who put in several hours, thank you for feeding us. Can we get a hand for the delicious food? And of course, I want to thank Heather Day, the Director of Community Alliance for Global Justice, for everything you do. This event would not be nearly as organized or well thought out without her important leadership. So thank you again. I also want to add that we are a membership-based organization. So again, please sign up to stay connected to us. Membership-based meaning that people give their time and their energy and their activism as well as money if they can to support the organizing that we do. So thank you again for coming and enjoy the rest of the day.
Justice Bill, are you in the house? Bill is going to announce what's coming next. Are you here, Justice Bill? Okay, well, he'll come back in, you'll be able to hear that. Thanks again, everyone, for coming. Really appreciate it. Oh.
Oh, once again, thank you guys all for coming to this morning's event. If you stick around today, then we are going to be doing, at 2 p.m., we're going to have the Alaskan Katia dancers perform, and then Muckleshoot, and then after that, we will be opening the floor, so there's a coastal jam, so if you guys want to stick around and see some more traditional performances, that'll be going on, and then we also still have stuff for sandwiches, chips, and water for later, too, if you guys get hungry again, so. Thank you all for coming this morning. It was a great turnout, and I'll see you. Yeah.
is. I can't read this. Before you all leave, I just wanted to make an announcement. I'm Charlotte Cote. I'm a professor here in American Indian Studies. And every year for the last 5 years, we have held an Indigenous food symposium here at the Wethlebalt called The Living Breath of Wethlebalt, Indigenous Foods and Ecological Knowledge. And we're hosting it May 5th and 6th, which is a Friday and Saturday this year. And I have some flyers here. They'll be up at the front. If you're interested in attending, it has more registration details. So that's May 5th and 6th, and it's a traditional Indigenous food symposium. Thank you.